Russell Boathouse, who recorded that, did the music for that with his son, actually, and they mixed that music behind Kirk's lecture there. Oh, that's from the CD.
What was that? What's that track called?
That was I am a paleobotanist.
Right. And why are you a paleobotanist? Most people think about, you know, fossil hunters and rock hunters, and they're going for the really cool dinosaurs. But you find pleasure in plants.
Well, here's the deal. I grew up in Seattle, and when I was a kid, I wanted to find fossils desperately. And it turns out that if you grow up in Seattle, you can go very close to Seattle and find fossil leaves and fossil pine cones.
Are you going
to
tell us where?
Why, like recounts in Issaquah, which is on the Olympic Peninsula, up in Chuckanut Drive, out in Republic, in Eastern Washington. It turns out the state is full of fossil plant sites, and that's what I ended up finding when I was a kid. I wanted to find trilobites and ammonites, and as I found fossil leaves, and pretty soon I found so many, I was a paleobotanist.
What are some of the things you've learned from finding these plants?
The fossil leaves are cool because they actually let you reconstruct ancient worlds. If you think about it, when you go for a walk in the woods, you're in the woods, and the woods are what the place looks like. You don't see necessarily the cougars and the bobcats and the bears, so when you walk in the woods, you see the plants. And so our view of landscape is based on what the plants look like, and if you want to reconstruct what the world looked like 100 million years ago, your first stop is to go collect the plants. You build the landscape. Then you can wander the animals into the landscape. But if you get the landscape wrong, you know, you're just off to a bad start. So I've come to realize that plants let you time travel. You can go back in time and rebuild ancient worlds.
More so than the animals.
Animals are just visitors. They just walk through the place. Just think about it. When you go for a hike, when's the last time you went for a hike and saw a bear? I mean, come on. But you see every dinosaur painting.
Last
tons
summer.
Of dinosaurs doing really cool, crazy dinosaur things. They always get the plants wrong, and which means that they've actually got the whole thing wrong, right? They didn't get the landscape.
It's a really good point, isn't it? And the other thing, too, that you learn when hanging around with this guy is that those, you just think, yeah, landscapes, it's another variation on a tree. But and when you go traveling back in time, those landscapes begin to just alter radically, and to the point where way back a long time ago, before flowering plants existed, it was just completely alien looking world, you know.
By the way, I was surprised that flowering plants have not existed for all that long. No, the problem with flowering plants is they're so dominant now. 95% of the world's flora is broadleaf flowering plants, grasses, broadleaf trees, things like that. Conifers make up a very small portion, then ferns. But if you go back 130 million years ago, there were no flowering plants at all, and the world was completely populated by different vegetables.
So was there a particular thing at the Burke, or was there somebody in your family, or was there something that struck you that all of a sudden, or maybe it wasn't all of a sudden, that led you down this path?
Well, you know, when I was 12 years old, my mom said, I just found out about this guy at the Burke Museum. Give him a call. And there was an artist named Wes Weir, who was an artist slash paleobotanist, who was a volunteer creator at the Burke.
And well, was your mom just trying to get rid of you? And why'd she think you would be interested?
Well, look, she had a 12-year-old kid who was fanatical about fossil plants, and she was desperate for some help. And so she called the Burke, and the museum delivered. And that's the thing. Museums are about winding kids up about science. And I was one of those kids that got so wound up that she launched me at the Burke, and I stuck. And there was this guy, Wes Weir, who was an artist slash paleobotanist, and I had found some plants, and he really supported that. I went to the Burke and said, oh, that's actually this interesting fossil plant. What about these? And we started corresponding, and I started going to the Burke and hanging out and reading books and looking at the fossils. And pretty soon, he had me corresponding with professional paleobotanists around the country. And there I was, a 13-year-old kid, sending fossils to Montana or the Smithsonian, from sites in Washington, and before I was 16, I was finding new species of fossil plants from the west coast of Washington, and people say, oh, this is a new species, we'll describe and name a new species, and that's really heady stuff when you're a kid to be actually contributing to science with real discoveries of undescribed things, and you realize the world is full of all these unknowns, and when you're a kid, when you realize that, it gives you a vision for the rest of your life.
How about yourself? I mean, if you've been an artist, were you also always interested in dinosaurs in the past?
My path was different than Kurt's in that I was a kid, you know, I picked up the crayon at age 4 and I was drawing dinosaurs, and that's what I loved. I can remember distinctly, it was the very first word I could spell just because I loved dinosaurs so much. And way back then, in the 50s, you remember this, Steve. There used to be dinosaurs. There was actually the first wave of paleo nerds, really, because you would get dinosaurs in your cereal boxes stuff. Remember those? And there were dinosaur trading cards and things. So they just were these magical beasts, you know, that transformed the way I looked at the world. When I first, you know, walked the Smithsonian as a Cub Scout at age 8, it just changed my life.